Thank you. Could I ask those members who are leaving the chamber to please do so quickly and quietly, as the final item of business is a members' business debate on motion 6610 in the name of Fulton MacGregor on programme promoting the benefits of shared parenting. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons. And I call on Fulton MacGregor to open the debate up to 7 minutes, please, Mr MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to bring this members' debate on shared parenting to the Chamber this evening, and I've brought this debate here this evening in my capacity as the convener for the cross-party group on shared parenting, and I'm pleased to see colleagues from all political parties here in support of it. And I know that it's been another long day in the Chamber where we've ran on, so I do appreciate everybody staying on. The cross-party group secretariat is run by Shared Parenting Scotland, and I would like to thank them for their support to the cross-party group and to members generally, and particularly John Forsyth, who's in the gallery today, and his colleague Ian Maxwell, and I'd like to thank them for their support in preparing today's speech as well. Since 2010, Shared Parenting Scotland continue to support well over 1,000 parents across the country in a number of ways, including through monthly local support meetings, authoring policy papers and other publications, and of course running a helpline. Shared parenting as a concept is pretty straightforward. In Scotland today, it is estimated that up to 30,000 parents separate every year. Research has also indicated that up to 33% of Scottish children will experience a family separation during their childhood. The notion of shared parenting asserts that the interest of the child is the most important consideration when separated parents make arrangements for their parenting. Although traditionally it has been observed that mothers are much more likely to be the main carer for their children post-separation, Shared Parenting Scotland have noted that the number of fathers with equal shared care is increasing. Shared Parenting Scotland also help those involved with separations that have occurred with same-sex couples too. There is a wealth of research which supports the notion that a child's development is positively impacted if their separated parents are present during their upbringing. For example, the Millennium Cohort Study was a longitudinal cohort study of around 19,000 children across the UK, which began at the turn of the century. One of the findings of this study was that among children of separated parents, more contact with the non-resident parent was associated with better outcomes for children at the age of 11. Likewise, in a recent study commissioned by Shared Parenting Scotland, which analysed the views and experiences of young people whose parents separated at some point during their childhood, it found that almost all contributors stated that they would have liked to have seen the parent they didn't live with more often during their childhood. And this all backs up previous debates that I was involved in around shared parental leave in the last session. I have long argued that we need to move away from the outdated notion that the mother should be the primary caregiver and the father the breadwinner, for want of a better term. Countries with better shared parental leave policies tend to be happier, with more gender barriers, particularly in the workplace, broken down. And these early days of parental involvement can set the groundwork for any decisions that may need to be made regarding shared parenting at a later date. In essence, it stands to reason that the more involved both parents are at the earliest stage, the more likely this will be sustained, whatever the circumstances might be. In short, Presiding Officer, when parents separate, it is in the best interest of the child that both parents remain present and involved during the child's development. But I should also, however, stress that there will, of course, be times when shared parenting will not work for every family or may be detrimental to the child, and this approach should only be encouraged when appropriate. The motion that I submitted reasserted this need for separated parents to work together, if appropriate, for the benefit of their children. The motion also highlighted a lack of support for those wanting to engage in shared parenting and that public policy should be introduced to help remedy this issue. It is with these matters in mind that I want to praise a pilot programme that Shared Parenting Scotland have launched. The New Ways for Families programme is the first of its kind to be introduced in Europe. At its core, it teaches and reinforces conflict resolution skills for parents going through separation or divorce. This is a key principle as it helps separated parents with conflict management, joint decision making, respectful communication and stress alleviation. These issues are so often the cause for the breakdown in post-separation parenting. The 12-module online course also includes 3 one-to-one coaching sessions delivered by experts across the therapeutic, legal and mediation disciplines, all of whom have been trained by the High Conflict Institute. The programme is completed upon the passing of a final examination, and this is in order to ensure participants have understood the content of the 12 modules. I can stand here and praise the goals of the programme, Presiding Officer, and laud its introduction, But the most important question is it effective? Most recent figures show that just under 30 parents in Scotland have now fully completed the course. Shared parenting have anonymously collected feedback, and the following quotes from those who have completed the course really underline how beneficial a programme like this can be. One participant said, "New Ways for Families benefits from being online, therefore giving a degree of flexibility to co-parents to complete their online modules where it best suits their lifestyles." Another said, "Really useful information. I expect I'll use what I've learned regularly as I progress through my parenting journey. Have learned some really helpful techniques and tips that will help me with what I'm going through." And a final quote, "My coach was beyond excellent, experienced, patient, knowledgeable. The sessions really changed how I relate to my ex-partner and his relationship with our child." Similar programmes have been introduced in North America and have seen comparable levels of success. A Canadian version of the programme resulted in 75% of parents maintaining and improving their joint decision-making around major decisions for their children and their overall involvement with their children. The programme also resulted in significant decreases in behavioural issues and stress and anxiety levels for the children of the separated parents. Shared Parenting Scotland will launch the New Ways for Families online training and coaching programme in spring this year for widespread use across Scotland, and that was one of the main purposes for bringing this debate to the Chamber, Presiding Officer, because I wanted to make sure that members are aware of it going forward for their constituents. The pilot programme was funded by the Scottish Government along with the National Lottery and a trust fund. Further funding is hoped to be sourced in order to help support the upcoming spring launch. Once established, the programme fees have been projected to cover the cost of providing the online training and coaching, as well as the administration costs associated with the programme. Shared Parenting Scotland have also voiced their desire to ensure that free or low-cost places will be offered to parents on benefit or low income after the launch, and I want to thank Shared Parenting Scotland for that commitment. Yes, certainly.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank Fulton McGregor and congratulate him on bringing a debate. He'll recall the work we did in the previous session of Parliament. I brought forward an amendment proposing a presumption of shared parenting, and I think he's absolutely right about the benefits that were seen internationally from that, as well as some of the concerns that were expressed about the need to always to have the rights of the child at the centre of any decision. Does he believe that through the work of this pilot and this further international evidence that we are perhaps closer to being in a position where that presumption of shared parenting may be safely introduced in a Scottish context?
Fulton McGregor.
Yeah, I thank the member for that intervention, and I'm glad that he took the chance to intervene, because he did come up and say to me earlier that had it not been for other commitments, he would have been here to participate in the debate. And I know that he is a strong advocate of this. And in answer to his question, I do think that we are moving in the right direction, but I think there is so much more to be done. But again, I want to thank Liam MacArthur for his intervention and work in this area. To conclude, Presiding Officer, I commend Shared Parenting Scotland on their initiative in piloting and launching this programme. The programme complements other such courses available in Scotland, such as Parenting Apart sessions, which are available through local family mediation organisations across the country. This three-hour group session is another resource that separated parents might consider as they transition to living apart while still wanting to remain part of their children's lives. So, Presiding Officer, when possible, shared parenting should be encouraged and supported. In adulthood, relationships do not always work out as people might want. However, the breakdown of a relationship should never mean that the child's well-being must suffer. A shared parenting approach can help alleviate the stresses and anxieties that children face during a separation, and is beneficial for the parents, children and wider family as a whole. I want to thank you again, and thank everybody here in the Chamber. I'm grateful for everybody who's going to participate tonight, and I'm looking forward to hearing their contributions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Begger. I call Bill Kidd to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Sorry for everybody leaving as I stood up, but there you go. And thank you to Fulton McGregor, MSP, for raising this debate today and for his important work as convener of the cross-party group on shared parenting. I have followed the issues raised by Shared Parenting Scotland with interest because Glasgow has the highest number of lone parent families out of all the local authority areas in the country, with 4 in 10 families being lone parent led. 91% of children in these cases are only being raised by their mother. This sadly means that a lot of children are growing up in Glasgow without a father figure, if we can put it that way, in their lives. Avoiding unnecessary relationship breakdown between parents and their children can be complex to navigate, especially, of course, when there has been relationship breakdown between the parents themselves. In these situations, it is helpful to have friends, family or support networks in place, like neutral third-party organisations that can offer support. Often it is the outside perspective, an organisation like Shared Parenting Scotland, which can facilitate mediation or meeting in neutral areas where a new way forward can be established. This is incredibly important, as the impact of having no father or mother in the home can be devastating for children. Sadly, in the UK, 76% of children and young people in custody grew up in homes without a father. We also know that there are many other poor statistical outcomes involving emotional and behaviour problems, neglect, teen pregnancy, alcohol and substance abuse, and poor school performance when there is parental breakdown in the home. Programmes that end cycles of the withdrawal of fathers, particularly as that's the majority from their families, are absolutely pivotal in improving outcomes for children. Wherever possible, joint parenting must be at the heart of shared parenting. I would like to highlight a unique initiative taking place in America, which is working to combat generational cycles of fatherless homes and criminalisation of children growing up without a father. This initiative is run by a Christian organisation, God Behind Bars, where they work to reunify incarcerated parents with their children so that new memories can be created and relationships built. One in four children, over 18.4 million children in the USA, are growing up in homes without a father present. As is the case in Scotland, these children are statistically more likely to live in poverty and potentially end up in prison. Statistically, 85% of the children in the USA who have a parent incarcerated will end up in prison themselves. So this reunification initiative is aimed at combating these generational cycles of incarceration and fatherless homes. At Christmas, they run the All Is Bright project, where the dads and mums pick out and wrap five or so presents, which have been bought by volunteers, for each child they have. They also get a new outfit to wear for the day, so they don't have to wear prison clothing. They then enjoy a Christmas celebration with their full family, with a full Christmas meal, gingerbread house building and games for their children for the whole day. This gives lasting positive memories for little boys and girls, giving their parents an environment where they can build relationships with their children again and an opportunity to start again. As one of the dads said, let me explain something to you. This is the true definition of what hope is. Look at all of what you see, what all these people give us. This is the only definition of hope that any of us need to see. For guys like us who have been down for such a long time, this is it. This kind of work, which puts restoration and transformation at the heart of parenting, is tremendous in its ability to restore relationships and break cycles of fatherless homes. I welcome initiatives like this and shared parenting models which value the role of both parents. As we do more to support this change here in Parliament, we will hopefully begin to see a growing positive impact on social outcomes for children reunified with their fathers and mothers both in their lives. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Rhoda Grant. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Kerr.
Delighted to follow Bill Kerr. He's given an excellent speech and support Fulton MacGregor's motion. Parenting is likely to be the most important role that many of us will ever have in life, and I've no hesitation in supporting any effort, any initiative, whether public or private, to maintain and strengthen the role of parents and the central place of the family as the fundamental unit of society. It's a wonderful gift and blessing to be a parent, to be able to see your child grow, develop new skills, and ultimately, wherever it's possible, become self-sufficient. It fills you as a parent with no small measure of feeling of pride in them, something that is actually quite difficult to explain. And make no mistake, a child needs the loving example of parents, as has been said by Bill Kidd. And no effort should be spared to encourage separated parents to work together for the good of their children. The enduring love of a family is like nothing else in all the world, and it is a huge responsibility to be a parent. You don't get any formal training for one of the greatest roles that you might ever be called upon to play. in those first few years of life, a tiny, tiny, helpless person who is wholly dependent on you enters your life. Your mindset must reframe around their needs, and make no mistake, it can sometimes feel overwhelming. I know that feeling. I think every parent does. And when you have more than one child, having time and money to send them to all the activities they become involved with and help them in their schoolwork and give them the love and the support they need is itself a full-time job. Those responsibilities come at a point in life, usually, when both time and money feel like scarce resources. It's quite a job of coordination. So every parent who is honest with themselves will tell of times when they feel overwhelmed, when the pressure is on and it feels like there's nowhere to turn. So what can we do to help? What can we do as parliamentarians to support and provide support to parents in these situations? Is it to remove responsibility, to transfer children's upbringing to an agency or a system determined by a faceless bureaucratic state? Or is it to empower parents, as we've been hearing, including supporting separated parents, and let them fulfil the responsibilities they have for their child that will make their children feel like the gift they are? And the answer is clear, as has been said by previous speakers. It is to empower parents. And every public policy and every piece of proposed legislation should be made to pass the test of family friendliness. Does this support the family? And children must never feel that they're a burden to their parents when they're growing up. Because if they do, they will likely experience issues of personal confidence, which will impact on their relationships and the direction of the course of their lives. So every effort we make to support good parenting, again, as has been highlighted by Fulton MacGregor's motion, is to me a solid gold social good. Families in Scotland are gloriously diverse. Every family is unique and has circumstances that are fashioned around the people who are in them. I will give way.
Bob Doris.
I thank the member for giving way. I'm enjoying the speech. And the member mentioned, Mr Kerr mentioned good parenting. As a father of two, there's no such thing as perfect parenting, and I think in the context of this debate we should all accept that we're allowed to make mistakes and there are no, it's not a clear black and white issue. We can be the best parents we seek to be, but there's no such thing as perfect parenting.
Completely Stephen agree Kerr. With Bob Doris. It's a work in progress and we're learning all the time from our children and indeed in my case our grandchildren about how to be a better parent and grandparent. But I would say, as in principle, that any attempt, any statist attempt to categorise families or to homogenise families is at odds with the reality of family life in all its varieties. A government that believes that the answer to everything is to increase its own powers is a government that is in denial of the nature of the root causes of many of the problems we face as a society. When more government is the answer, it's always worth looking to see if it wasn't the government that caused the problem in the first place. And we must recognise that a one-size-fits-all, out-of-the-box solution, which often the state reaches for, it rarely works. And we must not always reach for the power of the state as if it was the only responsible available to us, because it isn't, as has been illustrated by this motion. It is why the Scottish Conservatives reject the idea of the state empowering itself at the expense of parents. It's not an ideological position. It's a position that acknowledges love is the key ingredient in all of our lives, but especially in the lives of children. And ideally, love is added through a family. The family is best supported when the state is working to enable parents and lets families live their lives and pursue happiness in their own way. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I now call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Jeremy Balfour. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I want to congratulate Fulton MacGregor for securing this debate. And I also want to acknowledge, like him, the work of Shared Parenting Scotland, who help parents work together despite their differences to share the care and responsibility of their children and to provide them with the stability they require. It's inevitable that children face difficulty when their parents part. And there can be a great deal of animosity between parents when a relationship breaks down. The children can feel that they're being pulled in different directions because of this. Therefore, sensitive handling can ease the distress and reassure young people. It's therefore important to support parents to make the right decisions for their children and to help them reach amicable solutions that put their children first. We've all seen cases where parents have put aside their personal hurt and anger to ensure that the children's relationship with the other parent continues. We need services to to recognise the importance of shared parenting as well. Things like access to housing. Both parents need to have access to adequate housing to provide a home for their child. Too often we see the mother being given access to adequate housing while the father is not housed adequately to allow the children to come and live with him if they are shared parenting. In the majority of cases, both parents being involved in a child's life and future is the best outcome for that child. However, there are exceptions. I'm very clear that abusive parents should not have automatic rights of access to their children. Far too often we see family courts being used to continue to perpetrate domestic abuse by one parent to the other. I have many cases where abusive fathers use access to their children to identify where the mother is living in order that they may continue that physical abuse. And this is absolutely unacceptable, and neither is it acceptable to place the onus on the child to keep that information secret. I also have constituency cases where abusive fathers use the system to continue control, even where there is no physical abuse present. They make arrangements to see the child, only to cancel at the last minute if they become aware that their ex-partner is doing something else. While they have the child, they cancel the arrangement or return the child early in order to scupper these plans and exercise their continuing control over their ex-partner. Parents who use their children as weapons should not have access to those children. Neither should parents have access to their children when they cause damage in an abusive relationship. And we know that the life chances of children who are brought up in abusive households are severely impacted. It impacts on their ability to learn, on their self-esteem, which goes on to impact on significant aspects of their lives. These problems are a direct result of domestic abuse. Abusive parents should not have access to children until they can prove that they are no longer abusive and that the well-being of their children comes first. And I hope the Minister will address these concerns and advise how she will prevent abusive parents continuing to damage the lives of young people, even when that relationship has broken up. And I would like to see a system where that parent goes through a process of training and acknowledgement of their wrongdoing, a process that ensures that they will no longer continue to perpetrate abuse, a process that they must complete before they can have access to their child. This way we protect young people. For far too long, I have seen in my casework the impact of domestic abuse on families and how children are abused and used in that situation. We shouldn't allow it to happen. And I look forward to a day where the family court no longer allows themselves to be used as a weapon in domestic abuse cases.
Thank you, Ms Grant. And I call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Bob Doris. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'm happy to speak during this member's debate on an important subject that I believe deserves more consideration than often gets. Can I first of all thank Fulton MacGregor for securing time for this debate. It's been my pleasure to sit on the cross-party group for shared parenting, and I look forward to continuing important discussions that take place in that forum. Can I also wholeheartedly agree with the previous speaker and hope that the Minister will address the comments that she made there a few moments ago. Presiding Officer, all children deserve to be brought up in a safe, loving and in supportive environment, regardless of who they are or where they come from. Without this, their opportunities in life can be severely limited. As my good friend Stephen Kerr said, parenting is a great gift. I can say from personal experience that children can bring a lot of joy into a home. That's certainly been my experience with my twin girls. However, it's also a huge responsibility, requiring us to put others before ourselves and sacrifice for their sake. We often have to put our child's best interests before our own comfort or preference, and that extends to life after family breakdown or a parent's separation. There is now a substantial body of research that underlines the benefits of shared parenting for children whose parents no longer live together. Outcomes are significantly better for those who have regular contact with both parents, including the one that no longer lives in the home. We are lawmakers, and we should be doing everything we can do to provide incentives for parents to work together for the benefit of their child. We must support all efforts to support shared parenting, be it from governments or third sector organisations, to ensure that children are being brought up in the best environment possible. That's why I'm pleased to support today's motion and praise of Shared Parenting Scotland for piloting the New Ways for Families programme, which endeavours to give parents the skill set needed to manage their shared parenting responsibilities. Valuable skills such as emotional management and behaviour to cool things down, to help dialogue between parents and age decisions to be made outside a court. I know from personal experiences, being a solicitor and being brought up by a father who did family law all his life, that court is the last place you want to have to go to decide on parenting skills and who gets parenting rights. I'm pleased that a number of constituents have contacted me regarding the scheme, whose first-hand experience with the course is very complimentary of the service. They've told me that it's helped dealing with the situation without letting emotions run high, in addition to teaching them the benefits of healing themselves. They describe the coaches as compassionate, brutally honest and attentive. Deputy Presiding Officer, I want to thank again Shared Parenting Scotland for the real positive difference they have made in the life of my constituents and others across Scotland, and wish them continued success in the future. Ensuring that children receive the support and nurture that they require and deserve should be a fundamental priority for this Parliament, and I hope that we can continue to support the valuable work going forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Balfour. And I now call Bob Doris, who will be the last speaker before I ask the Minister to respond. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Doris.
President Officer, can I thank you for affording the right to speech? I hadn't intended to speak, but it's a higher quality debate, and I wanted to play my part within those discussions. Can I start by congratulating Fulton MacGregor, who's been a committee champion on shared parenting issues within his time in this Parliament. I absolutely commend you on your work in doing that, Fulton. And can I also welcome the positivity and dedication of Shared Parenting Scotland to engage with the legislative process in this place constructively and positively, and to engage openly about how to nurture and develop a child's relationship with both parents when there's been a relationship breakdown between those parents, and that's vitally important. As MSPs, we often only hear of parenting issues when things go badly wrong, and I think Rhoda Grant was alluding to some of that within her contribution. So, yes, we will have had examples of controlling coercive behaviour, of domestic abuse, of where courts have been used as a tool and a lever and a power control within in the embers of a dying relationship between parents. And also, I know from my experience how contact centres have not been of a required standard, and I'm pleased they will now be regulated by the Scottish Government, and those preparing reports within contact centres back to family courts will actually now have the skill set they should always have had in doing that, to make informed decisions in relation to child care orders, and I'm pleased to work in partnership with the Government in relation to that. And we should say clearly that in all the examples I gave, it is not always, but predominantly men who have been controlling and coercive behaviour, predominantly but not always men involved in domestic abuse and abusing the court system. But we can't demonise men. Most dads are great dads and they're good fathers, and they want to be better fathers, and we have to make sure that the structures we have in society are there for dads as well as mums. But we should put on record that all those negative issues we talk about predominantly impact women on society, and I'd not be doing my job properly as a constituency MSP if I didn't put that on record. So positive parenting before and after a spousal breakdown actually is vitally important as well. Who is to say mum and dad were doing a great job or a skilled job in bringing their children up before the relationship breakdown? It's a difficult job, as we've heard, made even more difficult with a relationship breakdown. So positive parenting before and after a relationship breakdown. And New Ways for Families programme sounds like a really innovative approach after that relationship breakdown in relation to that. And I wish it every success. And I think Fulton McGregor put some of those successes on record. And I look forward to hearing more about that. So,
Fulton McGregor?
Of course.
I was reluctant to intervene because it's quite an awkward position to intervene on. But I wonder whether the member agrees with me that, that part of this issue that we're talking about here comes back to something that I said in the debate about. It's a societal issue in terms of there's an expectation that mothers, I said about parental leave, that mothers do the main caring. And when people separate, it's the mother that does all the caring. And that's actually a barrier to gender equality. Does the member agree with that as well, that we need a cultural change around this, and actually agree with what Stephen Kerr said, that it shouldn't all be about governments intervening?
Bob Doris?
I thank Fulton McGregor for that intervention. I absolutely do agree with that. Maybe in relationship to that, it is an equalities issue. So we have to make sure dads are actually doing a shared parenting role whilst they're still within that relationship, because some of the issues we have in society is dads don't pull their weight within the relationship prior to breakdown. And you can understand the indignation of some mums when dads then demand all these rights that they weren't exercising before that relationship broken down. So you can get the idea of tensions, which is why I think taking those tensions out with that and New Ways for Families programme is an innovative way of dealing with some of that. Very briefly, Presiding Officer, if I have a little bit of time, I want to talk just a little bit about how we make sure we empower dads, irrespective of whether there's a relationship breakdown or otherwise. We know very well Dads Rocks, who are good friends of this Parliament, and what they do, but also Homestart Glasgow North Lanarkshire, my constituency, have got a dads group. I'm also minded that dads sometimes feel alienated from antenatal classes within the NHS. I was lucky enough that me and my wife could pay for an NCT 2-day class in a small group, interactive, real quality. What does shared parenting look like for mum and dad? And maybe that's the kind of thing that all parents, when they're starting a family, should be aware of, rather than waiting to talk about shared parenting when relationships inevitably, in some circumstances, break up. So really innovative work from Shared Parenting Scotland. Really pleased that Fulton McGregor has brought this to the Chamber today. But in the summing up, Minister, I'd really like to hear more about the positive work we can do before relationships go wrong, because that will empower people to do the right thing once relationships fragment. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Doris. I now call on the Minister, Elena Whittam, to respond to the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I congratulate Fulton McGregor on securing this important debate, which is actually my first chance as a minister to respond to a debate. So what a wonderful debate to do that. This debate has looked at fresh perspectives and initiatives on an area which can often be difficult and challenging: how to bring up children when separating parents do not agree. And the debate has raised a number of issues about parents who separate, including support for the children involved and support for the parents. And it is in our collective best interest that the rights of children are seen as paramount, and these rights are hugely important when parents do separate. And the Scottish Government is pleased to work with Shared Parenting Scotland, and I welcome members to the Chamber today. And in this financial year, we have provided financial support to them from both the Children and Families portfolio and the Justice portfolio. Our total financial support in 2022-23 for Shared Parenting Scotland is £77,574, including some money towards supporting the New Ways of Families programme mentioned in the motion in this debate. And following my recent appointment as the Minister for Community Safety, I will be meeting with Shared Parenting Scotland on the 2nd of February to learn more about their work and future plans. I am already aware of the valuable work they carry out through their helpline, their publications, their training, their group meetings, their WhatsApp groups, which I think is a fantastic thing to allow parents to be able to access them at any time they need. And all of this work supports separating parents through what is a stressful, emotional and difficult time. Research published by the Scottish Government notes that the stress separating parents are going through and the stress and trauma that are regularly raised in the correspondence we receive from parents going through this situation. And this stress and trauma can, of course, impact on how the parents speak to their children about what is happening. and in any disputes or disagreements between separating parents on how to bring up their children, the welfare of the children has to be paramount. And this underlying principle is the key in the legislation of the Children Scotland Act 1995. We need to follow that principle when disputes or disagreements between separating parents about bringing up their children are being resolved outside of courts as well as within the court system. The research carried out by Jamie Wark, who is a Robertson scholar, which is mentioned in the motion, raises how best to support children when parents separate. And I congratulate him on carrying out this research and on raising this very important point. The research shows that the separation of parents can have a direct impact on an individual's perception of relationships in their own life. So there can be longer lasting generational impacts, as we've heard from members this evening. And the Scottish Government has recognised that having separated parents can be one of the adverse childhood experiences, or ACEs, that we talk about. And Jamie Wark's research shows that children may not always have enough support and advice when their parents are separating. And Belkhead also outlined how this trauma can have lasting effects in his very eloquent contribution. And I think when we think about parents that are apart, especially if incarceration is involved, we need to remember the generational impact that can have. The Scottish Government plans to consult in 2023 on how best to implement the provisions of the Children Scotland Act 2020 on child advocacy services. And we will include in that consultation some discussion on how best to support children when parents separate, whilst recognising that parents, along with other trusted family members, will always be the key source of information for their children. And I think that speaks to some of what Stephen Kerr and others have mentioned. We need, of course, to make it as easy as possible for parents to communicate with their children. And one of the aims of the New Ways for Families project, which Fulton has mentioned in his motion and members also, is to make family separation less traumatic and stressful for parents and their children. And the aim of the project is to provide and enhance skills in a range of areas such as managing emotions, flexible thinking, moderating behaviour, and developing empathy and respect, with the aim to provide parents with the skills and insight to find solutions and to put their children first, which isn't always easy at a time when resilience is low and positions can become really entrenched. And as Stephen Kerr did point out rightly, as parents, we don't get a manual when our children are born. And this project helps to equip parents in this greatest of endeavours. And I think the skills are transferred into lots of other things within their lives as well. So those skills are really important. And the evaluation in North America as Fulton mentioned, showed positive results for the new ways of families. And I'm aware that initial feedback from parents who have gone through the pilot in Scotland has also been positive. And we've heard some of those experiences brought to life today by Jeremy Balfour's contribution from his constituent and Fulton himself, when he's quoted some of the parents that have gone through the pilot. Clearly, the full evaluation of the Scottish pilot is crucial to enable both funders and shared parents in Scotland to consider next steps in this area. And I welcome Shared Parenting Scotland's commitment to evaluate the pilot and look forward to hearing its final results. And it will be interesting to see if this really does mirror the positives that we've heard from the evaluation of the project in Medicine Hat in Canada. And, you know, the reduction in children's experiences of stress and anxiety and stomach aches and headaches and them acting out. So I really am keen to see that evaluation as it goes forward. The Scottish Government will continue to work with Shared Parenting Scotland, Scottish Women's Aid, children's organisations and others to improve our family justice system and, where possible, to encourage resolution of disputes outside of court. And I was struck by Rhoda Grant's contribution for a number of reasons, but one of the first ones was round about the surrounding housing issues. And it took me back to 2005 when I was proactively supporting my ex-husband to secure housing as we agreed to fully share the parenting of our son. And a lot of people don't recognise that that is for the benefit of the children. At the time, people thought it was a bit strange that I was doing that. We want to build consensus in this Parliament and amongst key stakeholders on how to support parents and children during separation and how disputes should be dealt with. There may well be differing views and perspectives, but there will always be common ground too in matters such as welfare of children and the reduction of stress and trauma. And it's also important to emphasise that we will always support both parents to be fully involved in a child's life where it is safe. As a former Women's Aid worker, I am pleased that Shared Parenting Scotland's approach recognises where a history of domestic abuse is at play. This must be fully considered, and contact should not be used to further and continue abuse at any point in the system. And I take on board Rhoda Grant's concerns and Bob Doris as well in this area, and it is something that I will continue to ensure is forefront in our considerations going forward. In conclusion, the motion and this debate raise some interesting questions, and importantly, we've debated some solutions too. And I really look forward to seeing the evaluation of the New Ways for Parenting's pilot. And I can assure the Chamber that we will discuss with Share Parenting Scotland the outcomes of the evaluation and their thoughts on how to best take New Ways of Scotland for families forward in Scotland. And I think also the whole concept of how we look at society as a whole is something that we have to look at cross-sector in all the different portfolios, about where families can actually be supported to ensure that children thrive in an environment where everybody has their best welfare at heart. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.